And welcome everybody here this morning. We gather together on this Lord's Day to worship our God together. We've had the opportunity for Bible class for the first time in about 6 months. We're seeing some brethren we haven't seen in a while, able to get out once again. And I'm so thankful that we can all be here together. In Ephesians chapter 5 and in verse 15, Paul makes a statement to the Ephesians. He says, "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil." Verse 17, "Therefore do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is." We understand that in our commitment to serve God, we also have a commitment to understand what God's will is, what is right, what is wrong, and understand what God expects of us to be pleasing to Him. And as Paul notes in verse 15, we are to walk circumspectly, implies an understanding of ourselves and our environment that we are in day by day, minute by minute. Be aware of possible sources of temptation. Be aware of possible sources of stumbling as we serve God. And that's why Paul says, not as fools, but as wise. Being aware, redeeming the time, verse 16. Verse 17, do not be unwise. Just as walking circumspectly is related to wisdom in verse 15, wisdom is also related, verse 17, to understanding what the will of the Lord is. This morning, I'd like to discuss one particular aspect of our service to the Lord. And it comes in starting in verse 18, where Paul says in Ephesians 5 and in verse 18, "Do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation." This term dissipation also is translated riotousness or riotous living. "But be filled with the Spirit." And of course, being filled with the Spirit is directly connected to verse 17 of understanding what the will of the Lord is. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and in verse 11, as Paul writes to the saints in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, he says in verse 11, starting in verse 9, he says, "I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexually immoral people. Yet I certainly did not mean with the sexually immoral people of this world or with the covetous or extortioners or idolaters, since then you would need to go out of the world. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral or covetous or an idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person." In 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and in verse 10, drunkards are listed among the list of those who will not inherit the kingdom of God. In Romans chapter 13 and in verse 13, read with me what Paul says in verse 13. He says, "Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy." As Paul writes, he refers to letting us walk, or he refers to the calling on the Romans, let us walk properly. That which is proper for the Christian to live. That term walk, we talk a lot about the term walk in a metaphorical sense, as is often used to reference the Christian life and conduct. He says, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but earlier he says, not in revelry and drunkenness. In Galatians chapter 5 and in verse 21, Paul also makes a statement regarding the works of the flesh. He says in verse 25, envy, or verse 21 rather, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But as some would point out, all of these scriptures have one thing in common. It refers to drunkenness or drunkards. And the question we want to ask this morning is to drink or not to drink. Not just be drunk or not to be drunk. Is it okay for a Christian to drink alcohol? That is the question we want to ask this morning. But we want to ask it from the perspective of what the scriptures say, not from what people say. The term that we find throughout the New Testament in reference to all these passages, like in Ephesians 5, 1 Corinthians 5, and 1 Corinthians 6, and so forth. The idea of drunkenness, the term that is used, methusko, the definition for the term in the New Testament that is used to refer to the drinking of wine or alcohol, the process of becoming or state of being intoxicated. You'll notice that the definition is not the state of being drunk. The term is the state or the process of becoming or being intoxicated. So what does intoxicated mean? It means affected by a substance that intoxicates. Fine. What does intoxicate mean? It means to affect temporarily with diminished physical or mental control by means of alcoholic liquor, a drug, or another substance. That's what the term intoxicate means. So when the Greek term refers to being drunk, and by being drunk, it means the process of becoming or state of being intoxicated. It is the process of becoming or state of being temporarily affected by diminished physical or mental control because of some ingestion of a substance. That is what the New Testament refers to when it refers to drunkenness in verse 21 of Galatians chapter 5. The conversation or the counter for which many people go to, even sometimes Christians, is that, well, the Bible condemns being drunk, not drinking. Well, the Bible condemns the process of becoming or being intoxicated. Whereas the definition for drunk changes with each person you ask. Not to mention each state individual law defining drunken driving. Each person may define, one person may define drunk as feeling tipsy, whereas another person may define drunk as falling out of their chair, not able to stand up, or someone who's passed out at the bar. So what is the definition of intoxicate? Because that's what we want to focus on. The process of becoming or the state of being impaired in some form or fashion, either physically or mentally, the judgment of our ability to determine right and wrong. At what point do we become impaired? Some of you may, it may be too small to read for some of you. All these slides are all in the notes, by the way. But here's some facts about alcohol. When we talk about one can of beer, one glass of malt liquor, a 5-ounce glass of wine, or a shot of hard liquor, in terms of the alcoholic content in your body, it all equates to the same thing. One shot of 40% alcohol is the same as one can of beer in the process of 1 hour, is how this is defined. That being the case, one single standard of drink, whatever it is, that contains alcohol, consider with me this fact when it comes to, and this is on official websites, wellness websites regarding alcohol. At the point of growing impairment, the BAC, which is blood alcohol content of 0.02, notice how that's defined. This is the smallest level that is determined in the blood, 0.02. Drinkers begin to feel moderate effects. And it goes on to define, below are the effects of increasing blood alcohol content. 0.02, mellow feeling, slight body warmth. Notice that last part. Less inhibited. Inhibited or inhibitions is that standard of conduct. What I would normally do, or how I would normally act, or how I would normally speak, when those inhibitions no longer are there, or are becoming softer or shortened, now all of a sudden maybe I do say things I wouldn't normally say. Maybe I would do things I wouldn't normally do and act in such a way I wouldn't normally act. At 0.02. Well, how much does it take to get to 0.02 blood alcohol level? Surely it takes maybe 3 or 4 shots of tequila. Maybe it takes a 6-pack of beer, cans of beer, to get to 0.02. See, I can drink without getting to the point where I am less inhibited. But notice this right here. How many drinks does it take to get to 0.02 blood alcohol content? For a male, 240 pounds, notice what it is, 0.02 after one drink. It's even greater in males who are of a lesser weight. The same with females at 240 and 220 pounds, 0.02 is the minimum blood alcohol level after one drink. And again, that drink is defined as one can of beer, one glass of wine, one shot of hard liquor. And notice, for someone who's 120, 140 pounds, it doubles, 0.04. Same for the men at 120 pounds. Where the baseline is 0.02, being this is where you start to feel lowering of inhibitions. Well, what is it that the scriptures teach regarding drunkenness? It is the point at which the process of becoming, or the point at which I become intoxicated. Well, what does it mean to be intoxicated? Where inhibitions are lowered. Where I am no longer, if any at all, I am in some way prevented from proper judgment. My judgment is impaired in some way. At 0.02, even if it's the smallest amount, a lessening of inhibitions is impaired judgment. The question of whether or not the Bible only condemns being drunk, not just drinking, we have to define it within what God's Word says. And we could talk all day about the difference between alcohol today and alcohol 2,000 years ago. People talk about, oh, well, Jesus drank wine and so forth. Understand that that 3 parts water to 1 part wine was mainly for the purpose of helping that water to purify it. In fact, the very argument that Peter and the apostles make in Acts chapter 2, when they were being accused of being drunk, Peter says, It's only the 3rd hour or the 6th hour of the day. We can't be drunk yet. Because that's how long it would have taken. It would have taken drinking all day long from start to finish to even begin to get to that point drinking what they normally drank. God's Word teaches us that we have to be sober-minded. The term sober-minded, nepho in the Greek, it means to be free from the influence of intoxicants. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and in verse 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting in verse 4. Paul says, "But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night, nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night. Those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation." Notice when Paul twice refers to being sober in contrast to being drunk. And again, that state of becoming or being intoxicated, even in the smallest amount, having that impairment of judgment. What's the contrast that Paul uses? Being free from the influence of intoxicants, having the ability to properly judge, to properly discern right and wrong. In 2 Timothy chapter 4 and in verse 5, Paul encourages Timothy to be watchful. Interestingly enough, that term is translated watchful, but it's our term nepho. When Paul encourages Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and in verse 5, Paul says, but you be watchful in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Paul tells Timothy to be sober-minded, to be aware of yourself, just as he wrote to the Ephesians in chapter 5 and in verse 15, to be circumspect. And then in verse 17, to know what the will of the Lord is, to properly judge right and wrong. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and in verse 3, 1 Peter chapter 1 and in verse 3, Peter says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. And as he describes all of this, notice what he says in chapter 5 and in verse 8. 1 Peter 5 and in verse 8, he says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Consider the contrast between chapter 1. Here's the promise that we have. Here's the salvation in Christ Jesus. Here's the glory that we look forward to. But here's the adversary that we face. Which is why Peter calls on the brethren to be sober, be vigilant, be free from influences of intoxicants, have sober mindedness and proper judgment. In Titus chapter 2, Titus chapter 2, and in verse 12, Titus 2, start in verse 11, Paul tells Titus, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. Throughout the New Testament, when you see the term sober or soberly, it's going to be one of these two terms. Either napho or saffron. Or sophron, sorry. This term sophron means self-controlled, of sound mind, capable of sound judgment. So when Paul writes to Titus, what does godliness teach us? What does the standard of God teach us? We should live soberly, having proper judgment, righteously and godly in the present age. That's what it teaches us to do. Now, people will counter with, well, didn't Paul tell Timothy to take a little wine for his stomach's sake in 1 Timothy? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. For medicinal purposes, there was nothing wrong with Timothy drinking a little wine for his stomach's sake. Sometimes after especially severe surgeries, we're given medication that makes us a little loopy, a little sleepy. It's to help with pain. There are times for medicinal reasons where taking certain things and then making sure that we're not in a position to be out and about and make poor decisions with others. We're supposed to be in bed, for instance, if you had surgery. We're supposed to be careful. That's why the warnings on the prescription bottle, do not operate heavy machinery, do not drive or whatever. Because it slows down reaction time, it impairs our ability to make proper judgments. But even with those medicinal purposes, we still have to be careful. When we take medications or whatever it is we're doing, but we ingest for a medicinal purpose, we still have to be careful. It does not give us free rein to act how we want, to say what we want, to do those things that are wrong and sinful. But when people generally talk about alcohol and drinking, they're not talking about for medicinal purposes. In fact, generally speaking, there are very few situations where a medicinal purpose would be qualified with alcohol. I had a doctor once tell me, after I tried a bunch of different sleeping pills because I was dealing with insomnia years ago. I had insomnia really bad. I went 72 hours without sleeping one time. And it was terrible. And none of the sleeping medications would work. And I had a doctor tell me, listen, I know you're a Christian and you've told me you don't drink, but you really need to take a small drink of alcohol before you go to bed. It'll help. And you know what? It did. It did help. But again, those situations where alcohol helps for medicinal purposes are few and far between. So when we talk about this concept of alcohol, generally, what are we referring to? What are the motivations why people generally drink alcohol? To fit in is perhaps one of the biggest ones. The people at work are going out to the bar and they've invited me to go. I'm at a business dinner and everybody has ordered wine and everybody's looking at me. What wine are you going to order? Is drinking alcohol for the purpose of fitting in proper reason for the Christian to drink? Well, remember, it's not that we're supposed to fit in. We're supposed to stand out. Let your light so shine before men, Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5, that they may see your good works and come to glorify the Father in heaven. What about those who drink because they seek to feel good? Pleasure. They just want to feel good. Or the opposite of that, to not feel bad. Someone who is depressed and they just don't want to feel bad. They want to forget their sorrows, so they drown their sorrows in alcohol. Is that how we deal with emotional issues? Is that how we're to deal with issues in life, hardship, times when we're depressed? We have resources at our disposal in God's word and in the brethren to help make us, quote unquote, feel good, to lift us up, to encourage us. There are going to be times in this life where we don't feel good. There are going to be times in this life where we may be depressed. And you know what? That's okay. Sometimes in life we feel that way. But that's when we have to be reinforcing in our minds our commitment to our service to God, our commitment to our service to our brethren, and let the brethren help serve us as well. Just appealing to alcohol for these reasons is not an appropriate reason, nor do any of these three even come close to falling into the realm of medicinal purpose. Are these reasons godly reasons? And that's really where the question resides. Not whether or not they're good reasons. Are they godly reasons? There are some, even people of faith, who vigorously defend the idea of social drinking. Why? Because one of these three things is served by it. That's why. Not because somebody needs to help sleep at night, or somebody's had surgery and they need medicine from the doctor to help them deal or cope with the pain. But because of one of these three reasons, people defend the idea of quote-unquote social drinking. No three of those are proper reasons to allow our judgment to be impaired. After one drink, our inhibitions are lowered. Whether you feel it or not, that's what science says. That's how that works. And generally speaking, if you ask a drunk, even a drunk who's falling over and passing out, are you drunk? Oh, I'm fine. I'm fine. They don't think they're drunk. And then to defend the idea of, well, you only getting drunk is wrong. Drinking is okay. That pre-assumes then the necessity to get drunk at least once to figure out where that line is. So in order to not sin, I have to sin so I know where the line is not to cross. That is the weirdest sense of logic I've ever heard, but I've heard that used. And it doesn't make sense. In Colossians chapter 3 and in verse 17, The last scripture we'll discuss this morning. Paul tells the Colossians, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Can we truly and accurately say that we can and should drink alcohol for any of these three reasons in the name of the Lord Jesus? This doesn't fit. When we're called to be sober-minded, to have awareness, to have the ability to properly determine right and wrong, to willingly do something to fit in, to feel good or stop feeling bad, that will impair our judgment and could cause us to say or do something that is not only sinful, but also cause us to be a hypocrite in front of our coworkers, our classmates, our friends, or our family. It doesn't fit with what the scriptures teach. That's the lesson for you this morning. I hope that this is something that we can look at with scripture, that we can determine what the scriptures say and make sure we abide by it. I hope this is something that's beneficial, that we are able to learn more from God's word and be convicted in his word, so that in all things that we do, especially when we're being tempted perhaps via peer pressure or some situation in our life to turn to alcohol or drugs or some other thing that would cause us to try to escape whatever it is we're trying to run away from, that we will first consider what God wants from us. He wants us sober-minded to be able to judge properly. Alcohol is not going to help us do that. That's the lesson. If you're subject to our invitation this morning, for those who are Christians, to turn from sin in your life, to recommit yourself to service to God, or maybe you just need prayers of encouragement, we're here for you. If you are not a Christian, you need to be baptized, have your sins washed away. We can do that right now. Whatever the case may be, we want you to get to heaven. God wants you to get to heaven. Do you want to get to heaven? Blessing is yours. If you're subject, come forward as we stand and sing.